tonight. Let me pray for us, and we'll get right into worship and going around the foot of the throne of our Savior. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for tonight, Lord, and the ability for yet again us to come back, Lord, and hear what you would have us hear, God. I know as staff and students of a Bible college, Lord, we can always get in that rut sometimes of being so overwhelmed with study, Lord, that we forget that intimate relationship that you call us to have. And so tonight I pray we put aside, Lord, anything that's worrying us about our courses or our classwork. And God, we just worship you now in this moment. And Lord, whatever word you lay on the pastor's heart tonight, Lord, let it refresh us, God. Let us see it as something that we can use in our tool belt for years to come for your glory, Lord. And so, God, I ask this in your precious and holy name as we begin tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, stand with us and let's worship. It's a privilege and an honor to always come to the foot of the throne, be able to sing about his amazing grace. And tonight, like I said last night, even though we don't have our traditional altar call at the beginning, remember this altar is always open. And I pray you'll take advantage of it. So at any time in any of these songs, if the Lord leads you to sit and pray, to come to this altar and pray, I pray you'll do that. So let us pray right now as we begin this time. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that those chains are gone, Lord, and that we can praise you in these moments. And God, I thank you so very much for the truth of your word, that we can be founded on it, God, that we don't have to worry about are we doing things right or correct, Lord. All we have is the plumb line of your scriptures, Lord, and that is enough. And Lord, your blood that covers us. So Lord, help apply those two things today as we continue to worship you, Lord. That wonderful, wonderful blood mixed with the word that tells us, Lord, how we should act, Lord, in a world that desperately needs to know how. So God, we thank you in advance, and Lord, how we declare that we need you in times like this. So bless us as we continue now in worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
gracious Heavenly Father, we come as we are, Lord, wanting and praying, God, not to be the same, Lord, to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, as your scripture tells us. And Lord, that's what we're about to do in this time of worship through your word. God, help transform us through that, God. Lord, help us leave this place different than we came in, Lord. Revive us, God. How simple a phrase that we say over and over, but how much we should cry out every day for it, God. Revive us, O Lord. And so, God, we thank you for what you're going to do tonight and the rest of this week and the weeks and months ahead. And we are quick to give you the glory and ask for your blessing now tonight as we enter in this next time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, good evening, everyone. I'm so glad that you're back tonight, and I pray that you've had a great day. This has been a good day for me. I've been able to get away, come aside, and spend some time with the Lord, and work on messages and work on other things, and pray for me. This has been a busy week. I preached at a pastor's conference on Monday, then came up here Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And then Friday, I'm on the road again to Nashville to speak at a prophecy conference about Israel. So, and then I've got to go back and preach on Sunday. And so there's no rest for the weary, but that's all right. You know, I'm absolutely convinced, and this has happened almost every service, after hearing the songs that were selected by our worship team tonight, I'm absolutely convinced that the Holy Spirit is in this whole thing, because it fits so well with what God has put on my heart to share with you tonight. So I want you to take your Bibles and turn with me to the Old Testament. Let's turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Back in those clean white pages in the Old Testament. So turn back there if you would to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And I want to begin tonight with our scripture text by just reading verses 1 through 3. And may we stand tonight in honor of reading God's Word. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 1 through 3. But then again, don't close your Bible, because we're going to stay right with the Word tonight. And we're going to look at what God has to say to us tonight. It happened after this, that the people of Moab, with the people of Ammon, and others with them besides the Ammonites, came to battle against Jehoshaphat. Then some came and told Jehoshaphat, saying, now listen to this, a great multitude is coming against you from beyond the sea, from Syria. Some of you may have a translation that says Aram. That's what it was called back in the day. Translated now into Syria, of course, where there's a bitter civil war going on. The same area. They're coming against you from Syria, and they are in Hazazon Tamar, which in Hebrew means the line of the palms. It's an oasis area down by the Dead Sea at the base of the hill before you would go up the mountain and head toward Jerusalem. And it says, which is in Gedi. In Gedi, if you remember, is the place where David hid from Saul in the caves and cut the corner of the robe off of Saul's robe. Could have killed him if he wanted to. But all of this is biblical geography. And Jehoshaphat feared. I'm convinced he was a Baptist. He was absolutely terrified when he hears that this enemy alliance is coming against him. But notice what he does. And he set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. I want to share a message with you tonight that I have entitled, How to Deal with the Multitudes. Let's pray together. Father, I just pray that as you have already taken the songs tonight and spoken to our hearts, that you would take your word and that you would encourage us tonight through your word. Lord, I don't know what everyone in this room is faced with, those who are watching beyond this room, but I'm absolutely convinced, Lord, that you have this message for somebody here tonight. So I pray that you would strengthen us and that you would encourage us and bring comfort in our lives And help us to know that we can trust in you with all of our heart, not leaning to our own understanding, but in all of our ways acknowledging you. And you, Lord, will direct our paths. And so, Father, we pray that now in the mighty and matchless name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. You may be seated tonight. You know, you study the words encourage and discourage, and you will discover that both of those words have Greek prefixes on the front of them. Encourage, discourage. En means to put courage into. Dis, D-I-S, means to take courage out of. And so if you're here tonight and you're encouraged, man, things are going great, and you've been encouraged, it's because someone or something has put courage into your heart. But if you're here tonight and you are discouraged, it's because someone or something has taken the courage out of your heart. So I pray that as I was just really praying, Brother Fox, about all of these messages, the thing that the Lord just kept saying over and over and over and over is encouragement, encouragement, encouragement. Encouragement to stand strong. Encouragement to be the best we can be for the Lord. Encouragement to finish well. All of that. We're going to talk about that some more tomorrow. But I pray that through this message tonight that you will be encouraged. But what happens when you're dealing with, we talked about this the other night, not just one situation in life, but maybe several situations, and it's all happening at the same time. You are dealing with the multitudes. When I was pastor at Hermitage Hills Baptist Church in Nashville, there was a couple that came to our church. They joined our church. He had been in ministry, but he had had an immoral relationship with a woman in the church. They had tried to put their marriage back together. He was no longer in ministry, but they came to our church. We wanted our church to be a place where they could heal, get back on their feet, get their marriage together. So they had been members there at Hermitage Hills about 2.5 years when I left to go to pastor First Baptist Church in Jonesboro, Georgia, in the Atlanta area. It wasn't long after that that the pastor, the new pastor of the church, called me from Nashville and he said, "Would you come and preach a homecoming service for us?" I said, "I'd be honored to." So we made our way up back to my former church. I preached there, and then at every good homecoming, you got to eat. Amen? So we were standing there in line, getting ready to go through the fellowship hall, and my wife and I turned around. And the wife of this man, this couple, the wife was literally standing right behind us, but without her husband. And I'll never forget, I turned around and I called her by name, and I had a smile on my face, and I called her by name and I said, "How are you doing?" And literally she burst into tears. Have you ever seen somebody cry so hard that the tears just come out of their eyes? I mean, I've never seen that very much, but I mean, this lady was broken. And so immediately my wife and I got out of line and we took her over to the side and kind of went in a little room where we could talk and have a little privacy. And I will never forget that conversation. She said, "Brother Dean, not long after you left, my husband decided that he wanted to continue to go after this other woman that had caused such conflict in our marriage. And so he left and left me, deserted me, deserted our family." She said our teenage daughter, who was real close to her dad, got so upset about the whole situation that she ran away from home. And I'll never forget what she said. "I think I know where she is tonight." Isn't that sad? "I think I know where she is tonight." She said shortly thereafter, "I was diagnosed with breast cancer." And she said, "Because I missed so much work, I lost my job. And when I lost my job, I lost my house." And she said, "2 months ago, I had to move back in with my parents." There was a lady that was not dealing with just one situation. She was dealing with the multitudes. By the way, I want to say this about the integrity of pastors. I want to insert this right here. I spoke in a class yesterday, or day before yesterday, and I just want to say this, that the four things that you must guard against in ministry: sex, silver, success, and self. Those are four things where Satan will come after you. He will try to destroy you. He will try to defeat you. He will try to end your ministry. So be careful of those four areas. But again, this woman was not dealing with one situation. She was dealing with a multitude of problems. So the question tonight is, and I don't know who this message is for, but how do you deal with the multitudes? How do you deal with those situations where it seems like the entire bottom of your life has fallen out? Maybe you're going through a financial crisis, you're going through a relationship crisis, you're going through a ministry crisis, and it's all happening at the same time. Well, I want us to see some truths that are in this story. Again, I hope you haven't closed your Bible tonight, because I want us to see some truths that will help us to deal with the multitudes. Now, you may say, well, you know, everything's going pretty good for me right now. You better take notes tonight, because the chances are really good that you're going to have to deal with some of these issues in the future. And it would sure be good to be able to look back and see what the Scripture says that you can do in the midst of those situations in your life. I want to begin tonight, as we develop the context, by looking at three things, asking three questions. So let's look at the text tonight and let's ask these three questions. Number one, it says that an enemy alliance was coming against Jehoshaphat. Now, who in the world was Jehoshaphat? By the way, that's my name in Hebrew, Jehoshaphat. I know, I look like I ought to be in Weight Watchers. Listen, Jehoshaphat literally means the Lord judges. He was the fourth king of Judah. Yeho, meaning the Lord, Shfat, meaning judge. In Hebrew, the book of Judges is called Shoftim, judges. Yeho, Shfat. And so Jehoshaphat means the Lord will judge. But listen, this was one of the good guys. Remember, none of the kings in the northern kingdom were any count at all. All of them were wicked kings. But this guy was one of the good guys. This guy had pulled down some of the idols in the land. This guy was trying to live for the Lord. And now he has an enemy alliance coming after him. By the way, I want to just add this. Joel chapter 3, verse 2 tells us that someday the nations are going to be judged when Messiah comes in the valley of Jehoshaphat. The valley of Jehoshaphat is the Kidron Valley. And if you look at your model that's out here, you will see the Kidron Valley on the eastern side of what was the temple, and the Mount of Olives over to the further to the east. That valley right there is the Kidron Valley. It's the valley of Jehoshaphat. And this is so powerful. The nations are going to be judged someday on their relationship to Israel, on their relationship of whether or not they tried to divide the land. Read Joel chapter 3, verse 2 when you have a chance. Mark that down and go read it. Guess what is just up the hill? How many of you have been to Israel before? Anybody? I know Brother Fox has. Guess what is just up the hill from the Kidron Valley in Jerusalem? Up the hill, on top of the hill, is the United Nations headquarters. Do you think that maybe God orchestrated that as well? When Jesus comes someday, hey, come down here. Come down here. We need to talk. The valley of Jehoshaphat, the place where the Lord judges. So who was he? He was the fourth king of Judah. He was a good guy. But look at this enemy alliance that came after him. Who were these people? Look at it. The Ammonites and the Moabites, the descendants of Lot's two daughters, as well as the people from Mount Seir, which are the Edomites to the south. Now, let me tell you how I learned biblical geography. This might help you in a geography class, a Bible geography class. How many of you have ever heard of the AME church before? African Methodist Episcopal Church. Here's how I learned who was on the east side of the Jordan River. Here's how I learned who was coming after Jehoshaphat. You have the Ammonites toward the north, you have the Moabites in the middle, and you have the Edomites down to the south. The AME was coming after Jehoshaphat. Now, I know that most of you are so brilliant that you don't need little tricks like that to help you to remember things, but I needed that. So this was an enemy alliance. Guys, look at your geography. Look at the map. This was like all the nations on the eastern side of the Jordan River and the Dead Sea. We're talking about a formidable army. We are talking about multitudes of soldiers that are coming against small little Judah, and they're going to attack them, and they're going to take away their land, their possession. One more thing. I just want to point out to you one more thing, and that is Jehoshaphat. If you'll read back in chapter 19, you'll see that when did the enemy come to attack him? When was the enemy coming after him? Right after he had taken down all the idols. Right after he had made a stand for God. Right after he had done the right thing and was trying to be a godly man, a godly king, and a godly leader. Listen, do you think that Satan knows when to attack us? Absolutely. He knows exactly. And you know when he often attacks? When we're trying to do the right thing. When we're trying to live for the Lord and live for Him more than ever before and love Him with all of our heart. So who was Jehoshaphat? He was the fourth king of the southern kingdom. Who was coming against him? The AME was coming against him. The Ammonites, the Moabites, and the Edomites. And when did they come? After he had made a stand for God. So what did he do? Look at verses 3 and 4. Thank the Lord that although he feared, and by the way, when you and I are in a mess, when we're in a situation, when we are in a dilemma, isn't that usually our first response? To be absolutely terrified. But look what he did. Look what verse 3 says from our text tonight. He feared, and yet he set himself to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all Judah, throughout the southern kingdom. So Judah gathered together, now listen to this, the whole nation gathered together to ask help from the Lord, and from all the cities of Judah they came to seek the Lord. And so this godly king begins to pray and to lead the nation to pray because the multitudes were gathering, the multitudes were coming after him. How do you deal with the multitudes? Three things tonight, right here in the text. We're going to look at them tonight together. Three ways that you deal with multiple problems that are coming, multiple enemy attacks that are coming in your life. Three things. First of all, I want you to see that he prayed. He looked to the Lord in prayer. Where is the first place? Listen, I've heard people say, well, we've done everything we can. I guess all we have left to do is to pray. Prayer ought to be your first choice, not your last choice. Look to the Lord in prayer. And notice His prayer. It's an incredible prayer. In fact, it's built around three things. First of all, His prayer appealed to the power of God. When you pray, you believe in the power of God. When you pray, you believe that God is hearing you and that God is going to answer. Listen how Jehoshaphat prayed. He stood in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, O Lord God of heaven, or of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, are you not God in heaven? And do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand is there not power and might so that no one is able to withstand you? Church, I want to remind you tonight that we don't serve some weak, anemic God that can't see, can't do, and can't respond to us. We serve El Gibor, mighty God. We serve El Elyon, most high God. We serve El Shaddai, God Almighty. And when you pray, you believe that this mighty, powerful God is going to come into your situation. His prayer appealed to the power of God. Look at the second thing. His prayer also appealed to the purposes of God. Look what he says. Are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend, forever? By the way, Israel, I talked to a couple of the students about this. Israel is God's stage. Israel is the stage where God has decided for His purposes, His plans, to enact the entire divine drama of all the ages. I want you to think about that with me for just a moment. How important is Israel? How important is the land of Israel? It's the stage. Church, where was Jesus born? Bethlehem. In what nation? Israel. Where did He grow up? Nazareth. In what nation? Israel. Where was His headquarters on the Sea of Galilee? Capernaum. In what nation is that? Israel. And by the way, the answer to every one of these is Israel. Where did He die on the cross? Jerusalem. What country is that? Where did He rise up from the grave? In Jerusalem, in Israel. Where did He ascend from the Mount of Olives, which is in Israel? Where is He coming back according to Zechariah? He's coming back to the Mount of Olives in Jerusalem, in Israel. Do you see that? God's stage has always been the land of Israel. I just want to throw this in here. I want you to think about this. Why did God bring the Jewish people into the land the first time? To prepare the place and the platform for the first coming of Messiah, who would die on the cross and be raised from the grave for you and for me. Why, listen, why after 1900 years has He brought them in the second time? To prepare for the second coming of the Lord, who is coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Does that make sense? Because He made covenant with them, it is their land. Did you see it in the text? It is their land forever. Israel is the stage. And God is setting the stage for the coming again of His Son. Well, we kind of got off track, but let's get back on track tonight. And they dwell in it, verse 8, and have built you a sanctuary in it. For your name, saying, if disaster comes upon us, sword, judgment, pestilence, or famine, we will stand before this temple and in your presence, for your name is in this temple, and we will cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear and you will save. God, we appeal to you not only on your power, but we know your purpose is not to harm us. Your purpose is not to destroy us. Your purpose and plan is to preserve us and help us and strengthen us. Listen, as you pray, dealing with the multitudes, you pray believing in the power of God, but you also appeal to His great grace and His purposes and His plan. I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. And then notice his plea to the Lord. Then he leads the whole nation in a specific plea and prayer before the Lord. Look at it in verse 10. And now here are the people of Ammon, Moab, the Edomites of Mount Seir, whom you would not let Israel invade when they came up out of the land of Egypt, but turned from them and did not destroy them. Deuteronomy chapter 2, Numbers chapter 20. Here they are, rewarding us by coming to throw us out of your possession, which you have given us to inherit. Do you see how specific he was when he prayed? His prayer appealed to the power of God. His prayer appealed to the purposes of God. His prayer also became a plea to the Lord. Lord, please save us. Please deliver us. Do you remember what Paul said in the book of Philippians? Don't worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, Let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your mind and your heart in Christ Jesus. It's like God posts His angelic angels, His army angels around your heart and your mind so that the enemy arrows can't go through and pierce your soul, your spirit. What's the first thing we ought to do when we get attacked like this? Hit the floor. Hit your knees. Get on your knees and pray and say, "Oh Lord, we need you desperately." Now I want you to look at verse 12, because this is one of the key verses that I want to talk to you about prayer. You say, "Well, I don't even know how to pray, preacher. The things have just fallen apart in my life so bad, I don't even know how to pray." Look what Jehoshaphat said. "Oh, our God, will you not judge them?" Now listen to these three things. "For we have no power against this great multitude that's coming against us. Nor do we know what to do. But Lord, our eyes are upon you." What a prayer of faith. What a prayer of faith. "Lord, I don't know what to do with this diagnosis that I've just learned from the doctor that so many people in our church have cancer, all kinds of illnesses. Lord, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to deal with this situation that's entered my life. I don't know how to deal with this financial crisis. I don't know how to deal with this relationship that's gone south. I don't know how to deal with this ministry problem that I'm faced with. Lord, I don't know what to do, but I do want you to know that whatever happens, my eyes are going to be upon you. I'm going to trust in you. I'm going to trust in you even though I can't see it right now." I want to tell you how God gave me this verse. I'd been at First Baptist Morristown about a year and a half. Our business administrator came in and said, "Brother Dean, I need to talk with you." That's always a bad deal. Sat down and our business administrator said, "I don't know how to explain this. Everything looks good financially on paper, but it looks like that we're missing some major money." I said to him, "Joel," I said, "it's either you or the financial secretary, because that's the only two people that handle the money." And I knew it wasn't him, because he's the one that called me about it. We had been saving money up for a new children's building. We had about $4 million saved up from over the years. We wanted to get into the building. We wanted to build it without getting a lot of debt. To make a long story short, the financial secretary of our church, who'd been an employee there for 47 years, took us for $1.6 million. Because she hid everything and disguised everything and moved it all around. When I heard that, listen, I'd just come a year and a half ago from a great church in Atlanta. And I heard that, you know what I did? Have you ever had a pity party before? I had a major meltdown pity party. I remember going into my office and just slumping down in the chair and just saying, "My ministry is over. You are forever going to be..." You know how Satan just gets after you and he just convinces you of all of his lies and his deceit and tries to steal away your joy. He tried to convince me that my ministry was over and I would forever be known as the pastor of that church where that woman took all the money. Now, let me tell you, it got worse before it got better, because 2 days later, the headline in the Morristown newspaper was "Largest Theft in the History of Hamlin County." It was at our church. We rallied our people together. I cannot tell you how great our people are. I can't tell you how great they are and how we prayed. But God took me to this passage. Man, I was dealing with something that I had no clue what to do. I had no clue how to navigate our church through all of that. I was dealing with the multitudes. Lord, I don't know what to do, but I'm telling you, my eyes are going to stay on you, and I'm going to continue to trust in you. And guys, listen to me. We had the best year of giving in the history of the church up to that time, in that year where she took all the money. God delivered. God saw us through. And God will help you if you're dealing with the multitudes. But the first thing you've got to do is pray. Look at the second thing very quickly. How do you deal with the multitudes? You look to the Lord in prayer. Here's the second thing. Lean on the promises of God. Go to the book. As soon as the enemy attacks, get on your knees with an open Bible and go to the Word of God. Look at verse 13. Now all Judah with their little ones, their wives and their children stood before the Lord. And what did God do? God raised up a preacher. God raised up a prophet. And look at his name. Look at who he is the son of, the son of, the son of. But understand it in Hebrew. His name was Jehaziel. Jehaziel means the Lord sees. The son of Zechariah, which means the Lord remembers. The son of Benaiah from Bone in Hebrew, which means strength, or to build in strength. The son of Jael, the Lord is God. The son of Mattaniah, the Lord gives. Do you see that in those names? I think that's why the writer put all of those names in there. The Lord sees, the Lord remembers, the Lord builds, the Lord is God, and the Lord gives. Those names are not in there just by accident, by the way. And notice the message that the preacher had for the people. Man, this is so good. Look at verse 15. And he said, "Listen, all you of Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, and you, King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord to you, do," listen, somebody needs to hear this tonight, "do not be afraid nor dismayed because of this great multitude. Now listen, for the battle is not yours, but God's." You think that'll preach? "Tomorrow go down against them. They will surely come up by the ascent of Ziz." That's Wadi Hassasa. Now, still there, still in Israel today, still a part of the topography of Israel today. "Come up by the ascent of Ziz, and you will find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel." You will not need to fight in this battle. Position yourselves, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord who's with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not fear or be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord is with you. Somebody need to hear that tonight. Don't be afraid. Don't be dismayed. God's got this. God's going to handle this situation in your life. You're going to look back on it and you're going to see His power. You're going to look back on it and you're going to see His hand. But I'm telling you, the first place you need to go is to pray. And then the second place, go to the Word of God and get a word from God. Let God speak to you through this blessed book. Let Him strengthen you. I can't tell you how many times I've opened this Bible in the midst of defeat and despair and being disheartened, and all of a sudden God just sends His Word, and He sends a word that just encourages me and strengthens me to know that the battle belongs to Him. One more thing, one more truth. You go to the Lord in prayer. You lean on the promises of God. Here's the third thing. We've been doing this all week. Lift up praise to God. Just praise Him. Just start praising Him even though everything looks like it's horrible. Just start praising Him. Verse 18, Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem bowed before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. Then the Levites of the children of the Kohathites, that's the choir right there, and of the children of the Korahites, that's the musicians, stood up to praise the Lord of Israel, the God of Israel, with voices loud and high. So they rose early in the morning and went out in the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Hear me, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you shall be established. Believe his prophets, and you shall prosper." And when he consulted with the people, he appointed those who would man the heavy artillery. Is that what it says? No. Look at this weird battle plan. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed those who should, Brother Matt, sing to the Lord. Sing to the Lord, and who should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army and were saying, "Praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever." Can't you just see some of the soldiers? What kind of green bean leader have we got? What is this guy doing? Where are the weapons? Where are the sword, the spears, the shields? What do you mean we're going to go out and sing? Yeah, we're going to sing. We're going to praise the Lord. You know what praise is? Listen, it's faith set to music. And when you praise him, when everything's really, really dark, there's something that happens. There's something powerful that happens. Worship team, you have done such an incredible job this week. Listen, there's a difference between performing and leading worship. You guys know how to lead worship, and I appreciate that. I've been in a ton of churches, ton of services. I'm telling you, God has his hand on you guys, because your praise has helped us to worship. Isn't this the same plan that Paul and Silas had? Now think about that for a moment. Remember Acts chapter 16? They got thrown in jail. They got beaten, thrown in the enteria, into the innermost part of the prison where there was no daylight. It was total darkness. At midnight, what are those two guys doing? I can just think about this conversation. Maybe Silas says to Paul, "Silas, you remember back there in our history where they were about to get attacked and they started singing and praising and God delivered them? Do you remember that? Why don't we try that? Hey, that's a good idea. Let's sing something." And at midnight, they start singing and praying unto the Lord. And what happened? Earthquake came. They all were freed. That's what praise does. By the way, Isaiah 66 says that the earth is God's footstool. Don't you imagine that as they're praying in the midnight hour, those songs go up through the roof of the jail, they go all the way to heaven, and God hears that tune, and he starts tapping his foot, and the earthquake came. Set them free. That's what praise will do. It'll set you free. What do you do when the multitudes attack? You go to the Lord in prayer. You appeal to his purposes, to his power. You plead, you cry out to him. Then you go to the book. You find your strength in the Lord in this word. Let the Spirit of God speak to you through his word. And then you just begin to praise him. Just lift up your praise to the Lord. Lord, thank you that you are our great and mighty God. Well, church, what happened? Let's look at the rest of the story. What was the result? Verse 22. "Now when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushes for the people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, who had come against Judah, and they were defeated. For the people of Ammon," I love this, "the people of Ammon, Moab, stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir to utterly kill and destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, they helped to destroy one another." You know what I've discovered? Nothing confuses the enemy like God's people praying and praising and going to the Word when the bottom has fallen out. The enemy says, "What? They're not supposed to act like that. They're supposed to be defeated. They're supposed to be deflated. They're supposed to throw in the towel. They're supposed to quit." Nothing confuses the enemy like praise in the midnight hour. So when Judah came to a place overlooking the wilderness, they looked toward the multitude, and there were dead bodies fallen on the earth. No one had escaped. When Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away their spoil, they found among them an abundance of valuables on the dead bodies and precious jewelry, which they stripped off for themselves, more than they could carry away. And they were 3 days gathering the spoil because there was so much. And on the fourth day, they assembled in the valley of Berakah. That means blessing in Hebrew. For they were blessed by the Lord. Therefore, the name of that place was called the Valley of Berakah unto this day. Then they returned, every man of Judah and Jerusalem, with Jehoshaphat in front of them, to go back to Jerusalem with joy. For the Lord had made them rejoice over their enemies. And I love this, Brother Matt. Look what happened. And they came to Jerusalem with stringed instruments. I believe they had a banjo. Stringed instruments and harps and trumpets to the house of the Lord. And the fear of God was on all the kingdoms of those countries when they heard that the Lord had fought against the enemies of Israel. Then the realm of Jehoshaphat was quiet, for his God gave him rest all around. Look to the Lord in prayer. Lean on the promises of God's word and lift up praise to him when the multitude attacks your life. Would you just bow your head for a moment? Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I want to handle the invitation a little differently tonight. I've asked Brother Matt if he would come. And here's what I want us to do. I want us to do what the Scripture says. I want us to sing a praise song to the Lord. And somebody here today, you may be facing a very, very difficult time. Can I encourage you right now to give it to the Lord? Can I encourage you right now that we sing this song together as a praise unto God? And if anybody feels led of the Lord tonight to come to the altar, maybe to bring your burden to the Lord and just leave it with Him, you're welcome to do that. Or maybe you've got a friend tonight that's going through a hard, hard time. Maybe not even in this room, but they're going through a hard time. And you want to come and pray for them. Appeal to that mighty and powerful God tonight in their behalf. But whatever it is, we're going to open this altar and we're going to praise the Lord as we end this service tonight. So, Brother Matt, would you lead us as we sing? Let's all stand together. And if God leads you to come to the altar, that's great. But let's praise His holy name.
Lord.
shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Praise and all the glory tonight. For those that are dealing with the multitudes, help us, Father, to trust in you. Lord, we love you and we thank you that you love us and that you have our best in mind. So lead us and guide us. Help us to have a great night's rest and bring us back tomorrow for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, everyone. Good night.